Well, everybody, I'd like to wish all of you a good evening and welcome to the College of Complexes. My name is Tim, and we're going to get right into this. There's only two rules here at the college. One is one fool at a time, and the second is no personal attacks. The college consists of three specified formats where our speaker speaks. We have an extensive question and answer period. And third, we're going to have the infamous rebuttal period. Again, my name is Tim. I'll be handling the technical stuff. I'd like to thank Charlie again.
Introduce our speaker, Mike Flores.
Howdy. Now, you'll remember when I did the Joe McCarthy speech back in 2006, the references that I used, which was from CIA, was the pond. If you looked on the internet, there was only one place where you could go to read about the pond and the CIA, and that was on their website, Strategies and Intelligence. Today, if you Google the pond and Joe McCarthy, you will find thousands of links now, newspaper articles, stories. I was just a little bit ahead of the curve. But what I did, what I discovered, was started by asking a question no one had ever asked before. No one had ever asked, where did Joe McCarthy get the list of names from? Seems simple. Some people said he just made them up randomly. Then I discovered there were two lists. There was a second list that the American public was never told of. That list listed KGB agents within the CIA. Every single person on that list was arrested, okay? But I only discovered this by asking the question no historian had asked, who gave Joe the names? So I began my study on the Hollywood 10 and the hearings that happened with the House of Un-American Activities by again asking a question no one, either left or right, had ever asked. Why did the Hollywood 10 decline to answer the question if they were communists or not? Seems pretty simple. It's the basis of the whole case. And yet no one ever said, what was the strategy? What was the reason that they refused to answer the question? Now, Humphrey Bogart had given me some clues, because Bogart had worked with the Hollywood 10 and the Lawyers Guild who were shaping the case. And Bogart said, just get up there and say I'm a communist. So what? It's not illegal. You don't have to make yourself martyrs. You don't have to go to jail. Just get up and say, yeah, I'm a communist. So what? I can vote communist. It's on the ballot. It's a legal party. And the lawyer mocked him, made fun of him, told him that he was petty bourgeois, that he didn't understand the class struggle, and that the way for the Hollywood 10 to live on in history would be to go down fighting for a principle. Instead of just standing up to HUAC and saying, yeah, I'm a communist, so what? Okay? So that was the first clue I got, that there was a strategy and that they were doing that deliberately and had a reason. Now, I want, Tim, if you could please, if you could show the Hollywood 10 documentary. I think you even have it downloaded down there. But anyway, this is their own words at the time.
They cannot have both. One or the other must be abolished in the immediate future.
These are the Hollywood 10. These eight. These two. In the fall of 1947, they were subpoenaed to appear before the House Committee on Un-American Activities, whose chairman was J. Parnell Thomas. They had not behaved to Mr. Thomas's satisfaction, and they were declared to be in contempt of Congress. They were tried and declared guilty. They appealed their cases to the higher courts, and their appeal was denied. All 10 are now in federal prison, serving one-year sentences. We should like you to meet them. Albert Walls, 41 years old, born in Brooklyn. Novelist, playwright, writer of short stories and screenplays. His works are read in other countries. They won prizes. The U.S. Army distributed this book to soldiers. His film, Destination Tokyo, was premiered by the Navy. The Marines praised him for pride of the Marines. And the film industry honored his film on racial tolerance. His family will try to weigh these honors while he spends a year in federal prison. Lester Cole, born in New York City, 45 years old. He was a founding member of the Screenwriters Guild and served on its executive board as president and vice president. When he was summoned by the House Committee, he was a valued writer at this film studio, signed to a new contract to write and produce on that very day. Author of 40 screenplays, among them, Romance of Rosie Ridge, Objective Burma, None Shall Escape. He is now in prison. Samuel Hornitz, 60 years of age, born in New York, novelist and screenwriter, lecturer and scholar. Author of a classical fictional study of American Jewish life, of a tender story for children, of a book whose hero was lynched by anti-Catholic bigots. As a social worker, he spent many years with the Prison Association in New York, helping thousands of people to get out of prison. He is now in prison himself. Adrian Scott, screenwriter and motion picture producer, born in New Jersey, 39 years old. This film studio considered Scott's services invaluable. His films were successful and celebrated. Do you remember Crossfire?
Oh.
It was not to the taste of J. Parnell Thomas. Now Adrian Scott, too, is in federal prison. Alva Bessie, born in New York, age 46. Newspaper man, novelist, critic, and screenwriter. In the year 1938, he made his way across the Pyrenees as a volunteer for democracy. On the witness stand in Washington, he said, "I not only supported the Spanish Republic, but it was my high privilege to serve in the ranks of its international brigade." He returned to the United States to write an account of that war, and in the Second World War, served as second lieutenant in the Civil Air Patrol, Los Angeles Squadron 3. He wrote films as a contract writer for Warner Brothers Studios. He is now in prison. Edward Dimitri, 41 years old, motion picture director. These films and many others were directed by Edward Dimitri. As a reward for his distinguished contribution to world films, 1 year in prison. Gwynne Lardner Jr., born in Chicago, 34 years old. Two of his brothers died in separate chapters of the world's struggle for democracy. One as a volunteer in the Loyalist forces in Spain, the other in Germany as an American war correspondent. Himself, author of a dozen screenplays, for one of which he received the highest award of the film industry. This film he wrote for a trade union to advance the idea of the equality of all races, of all nationalities. Ring Lardner Jr. is now a federal prisoner. John Howard Lawson, born in New York City, 56 years old. Volunteer ambulance driver in Italy in the First World War. Author of 9 plays. Author of many screenplays. Perhaps you remember some of them. A teacher, scholar, historian. He completed the first volume of A History of American Culture just before he entered prison. This is Mrs. Lawson. She and their children will wait for him. Herbert Biberman, 50 years old, born in Philadelphia. He directed plays for the Theater Guild, the leading theatrical organization of America. He produced and directed films for various motion picture companies. He was the organizer of the Hollywood Anti-Nazi League, one of the first groups to warn the world against socialism. Always, he devoted his energies to decency and humanity. He is now in a federal prison. Thornton Trumbo, born in Colorado, 44 years old, writer of novels. A writer of pamphlets in the tradition of Zola and Thoreau. Writer of films. Kitty Foyle, a guy named Joe, 30 seconds over Tokyo. War correspondent in the South Pacific. Special consultant at the first United Nations conference in 1945. 5 years later, he said goodbye to his family to go to prison. 10 men. What was their crime? Why are they in prison? There were two questions. Listen.
Hello, Mr. Trumbo.
Are you a member of the Screenwriters? Glad to hear you.
Mr. Strubel, the right of American labor to inviolable secret membership list has been won in this country by a great cost of blood and a great cost in terms of hunger.
Are you now, have you ever been a member of the Communist Party? Unless it has been changed since yesterday, in our country we have a secret ballot. And I do not believe this committee has any more right to inquire into my political affiliations than I believe that an election official has the right to go into the voting booth and examine the ballot if this is marked by the voter.
No.
That's J. Parnell Thomas. He has been put in prison as a common thief. But the 10, do they belong there?
We don't like the idea of going to...
If you could put up the screenshot, I think it's called Devils or Demons, the still photo, that would be funny. It should be noted that the Supreme Court ruled that they had no right to refuse to answer the question if they were members of the Communist Party or not. There was no threat against them for being members. The threat, as we are about to learn, is from the questions that would have followed about their actions prior to World War II and the use of the film industry to spread propaganda. Now, who were they? Well, Bessie, who we just saw up here, bragged about planting messages in action in the North Atlantic. Herbert Biberman was suspected of being a Nazi spy by the FBI for his open love of Adolf Hitler and attacks on FDR and Churchill. He was actually initially not suspected of being a communist by the FBI because he had been at meetings with the German-American Bund in dealing with the machinist strike in Los Angeles. They thought he was a Nazi. His praise of Hitler for registering Jews and bringing a new form of socialism to the world made the FBI first suspect he was a Nazi. Lester Cole bragged that it was easy for him to spread pro-Stalin propaganda in his movies that he wrote. Edward Dmytryk was the only one of the 10 to renounce communism and then made an interesting comment to the New York Times. He said the support of Hitler by the Communist Party USA before World War II was far worse than either the House of Un-American Activities or the FBI ever suspected. Ring Lardner Jr. wrote that Hitler was the savior of the German working class. John Howard Lawson was the enforcer of the party line in Hollywood and reported directly to Soviet intel. Albert Maltz tried to protest the idea that refusing to answer questions was the wrong way to go. He was the one member of the 10 that backed Humphrey Bogart and said, to hell with this, let's just say we're communists. What are they going to do? Well, he also protested the treatment of Bogart by the lawyer, Lawrence Bielenson, the lawyer for the 10. He was bullied into going along with the idea of not answering the question. Samuel Ornitz was also at first spied on by the FBI for being a prominent member of the pro-Hitler movement prior to the war, and in aiding the National Socialists in acts of sabotage and strikes in the defense industry in a coalition with the German-American Bund. Adrian Scott did a film noir called Cornered and was attacked for not putting any propaganda in it. The film was actually condemned by the Daily Worker newspaper, and he was given a warning in the newspaper, start saying good things about the working class. He was told the Hollywood 10 hearings would be the chance for him to redeem himself. Samuel Ornitz was at first spied on by the FBI for his work with the German-American Bund and his pro-Hitler letters to newspapers of the day. Dalton Trumbo, who Hollywood is about to put out a major motion picture on, backed Stalin, Kim Il-sung, and supported, in print, Hitler registering Jews and isolating them from the population. How could communists be suspected of being Nazis? What kind of topsy-turvy world have we now entered? Is the FBI just screwing up their investigations? Here's what Karl Marx said about Jews. Let us consider the worldly Jew. Let us not look for the secret of the Jew in his religion, but let us look for the secret of his religion in the real Jew. What is the secular basis of Judaism? Practical need, self-interest. What is the worldly religion of the Jew? Huckstery. What is the worldly God? Money. Very well then, the emancipation from huckstering and money would be the emancipation of our time. In the final analysis, the emancipation of the Jew is the emancipation of mankind from all Jewry. So communists already believed before Hitler what should be done with the Jews who refused to renounce their religion. All the Hollywood 10 joined the Communist Party, knowing that was one of the planks. Karl Marx also called for the elimination of the Slavic people so that the German people could fill their regions. Every single member of the Hollywood 10 knew that when they joined the Communist Party. All socialists and communists prior to World War II aligned themselves with the kill all Jews who remained religious camp. Ever hear of Gerhard Eisler? He was supported financially by Dalton Trumbo. When he was called in for questioning by the FBI, he fled America for East Germany. But let's back up. How on earth did communists in America come to support Hitler and rounding up Jews and killing Slavs? The year Hitler and Stalin came together in Germany, all Polish Jews and Jews in general were ordered to take their pets and their entire family to the animal hospitals. And in 1938, Polish Jews and Jews in Germany, their families stood and watched as the doctors killed their pets in front of them. This is what was going on when the Communist Party USA declared that Adolf Hitler was a brand new form of socialism. The Communist Parties of the world supported this action. They backed Hitler registering all Jews and ordered Communist Party members in Germany to help with the process. In return, the German newspaper Die Welt was allowed to be sold again in public in Germany from 1938 until 1941, halfway through 41. This was due to the Ribbentrop-Hitler peace treaty that they had signed. Tim, if you could put up the Ribbentrop slide.
Yeah.
Now, what we now know came from Molotov representing Russia, Ribbentrop representing Germany. What we now know is that their plan for what to do with Europe pretty much happened, and that Stalin had actually been preparing to build an empire long before World War II. Now, this treaty divided Romania, Poland, Lithuania, Estonia, Finland. The Communist Party USA, as well as all communist parties around the world, backed the invasion of Poland by both countries. They supported the German murders of 60,000 Polish nobles, teachers, social workers, artists, and priests. After all, they were the petite bourgeoisie. Hitler's plan was to move all Polish people to Siberia and give the land to Germans to resettle, which of course was an idea he got from Marx. About 330,000 were killed by Germans and their land was given to Germany. Another 2.5 million were sent to Germany as forced laborers. The Soviets deported 1.5 million Poles and gave their land to Russians. By January of 1940, 1 million of those 1.5 million sent to the gulags in Russia and Siberia had died within 1 year. So what were socialists saying while all this was going on? Socialists were different than the communists. Trotsky had predicted that Hitler and Stalin would unite 2 years before he died. He said it was inevitable. Herbert Biberman of the Hollywood 10 called that Trotskyism and said no Trots would ever be allowed at a Communist Party meeting because all they did was lie. There was no chance Hitler and Stalin would ever make a deal. Prior to the Hitler-Stalin peace pact, Earl Browder, head of the Communist Party USA, said there is as much chance of agreement as Earl Browder being elected president of the Chamber of Commerce. When the pact was signed, the Soviets made clear no discussion was to be allowed by any communist parties in the world. There would be no discussion. All anti-Nazi and anti-fascist rhetoric was to be condemned. All communists were ordered to push against war with Germany. denouncing it as a capitalist war against a brand new form of socialism. Stalin and Hitler were both nominated that same year for the Nobel Peace Prize. The German communist paper, now allowed to be sold again openly in Germany, Die Welt, warned France and England that their attacks on Hitler would not be tolerated and the world working class would rise up to crush them. Molotov declared that war in Germany was in fact war on Hitler and his bold new vision of socialism. The British had a blockade of Germany that the Soviets were able to break by going through Poland. This was hailed by all communist parties around the world as raw materials were poured into Germany from Russia. They also, the first 6 months of the pact, poured in 1 million tons of cereal, 500,000 tons of wheat, 900,000 barrels of oil, 100,000 tons of cotton. The Germans, in return, gave the Russians the plans for the Bismarck, heavy naval guns and warplanes, including the ME-109 and 110 fighter jets. A submarine base set up by Russia, Basis Nord in northern Russia, was used by Germans to attack American and British ships in the Arctic region. At least 11 American ships were sunk, and all on board were killed so that word would not get back to the U.S. that Germany and Russia were sinking ships together. Had we found that out, we would have been at war with both Russia and Germany. We didn't find out till years after the war. Lester Seaborn and Stephen England, in their defense of the Hollywood 10, in a book called The Inquisition in Hollywood, said, "We're the Hollywood 10 Stalinists." Well, yes, they defended the Stalinist regime, accepted every Comintern order, and even all the about faces and reversals. They criticized enemies and allies alike with an infuriating self-righteousness, superiority, and selective memory that it did eventually alienate everyone away from them except their strongest fellow travelers. This is from their defenders. As defenders of Stalin, they became apologists for crimes not only committed by Stalin, but Hitler as well. By the way, the trailer you saw earlier for the Moscow one, Mission to Moscow, that trailer shows you pretty much what the movie's about. It justifies the purge trials that happened in Russia. Now today, of course, Russia says those were a mistake, those people were all innocent, but here Hollywood made a movie, Mission to Moscow, which said no, they were all guilty. Stalin's judges were right, they were treated legally and fairly, although today we now know they were not, they were all innocent. They were just being killed to be made examples of. As the 10 defenders, Cedar and England would say, the Hollywood Reds defended the Soviet Union unflinchingly, uncritically, inflexibly. And this is from their supporters. Of course, in their book, they don't even mention the Hitler-Stalin peace pact and what went on for almost 3 years. In 1935, several of the Hollywood 10 formed the League of American Writers. They declared in their statement, all art must be propaganda for the workers, The American labor movement? IWW? Union organizing? No. All art must be propaganda praising the Soviet Union and Stalin. They must be weapons of the working class to bring the Soviet Union to power in the United States. That seems pretty damn clear to me. Waldo Frank, elected the League's chairman, stated in his acceptance speech, "My premise is that communism must come and it will be fought for." The convention ended with the singing of the Internationale. You heard that version by Paul Robeson earlier.
That was not the Internationale. That was the Russian...
Okay, it's the anthem, sorry.
Adopted in 1935.
Let me keep going here. We'll never get out of here.
You got a few more, you're fast.
The convention ended with the singing of what we saw, the anthem. Okay. Three of the 10 helped set up the group Lawson, Ornitz, and Maltz, as well as Dashiell Hammett, Lillian Helmuth, and Donald Stewart, all pledged that they were obligated at all times to back the Soviet Union and Stalin. In 1937, before the Hitler-Stalin Peace Pact, many American and French communists were shocked by the show trials in Russia. CPUSA head Earl Browder condemned all communists who questioned the trials. That was when Walter Frank made a mistake. He was the first American communist to say the trials and purges in Russia were out of control and obviously fake. He was quickly replaced by Hollywood 10 member Donald Stewart, who said Frank had betrayed socialism. Stewart stated that violent revolution was the only way to stop the United States and make it part of the progressive Soviet Union. In June of 1938, the Congress of Writers denounced Hitler. They called for France, England, the US, and Soviets to unite to stop Hitler. And then the Comintern changed the game plan. Before this Hitler-Stalin alliance, the CPUSA formed the Hollywood Anti-Nazi League, which was paid for by Russia. The Anti-Nazi League scored their biggest victory when they convinced Washington to have a full economic boycott of Germany. Bogart, Joan Crawford, Paul Muni, John Ford, Edward G. Robinson, James Cagney, Bette Davis, Henry Fonda, Groucho Marx, Dick Powell, all pushed for the boycott, and they were all shocked when overnight, without warning or discussion, the group's name was changed to the Hollywood League for Democratic Action. To the shock of non-communists who had joined the cause, the group came out in support of work camps for Jews and undesirables. Supported Jews being forced to register and wear stars, and in support of German work camps, quote, so the rich can learn what work is. The group called for anti-war films and stories and openly supported the Soviet invasion of Finland. They condemned all anti-Hitler propaganda as war hysteria started by Zionists. Censor boards in democratic cities from Chicago to Boston to San Francisco banned all newsreels which showed any mistreatment of Jews by Germans. The left was united. All of the Hollywood 10, all Jews who had renounced their religion, now supported registering and isolating the Jews in Germany.
You're done?
Hitler was now called a liberator. The Popular Front against Hitler was dropped immediately. Germany was now the example of the new triumphant socialism. Keep America Out of War groups suddenly took the place of anti-Nazi organizations. In Hollywood, new communist-run front groups appeared. The Hollywood Peace Forum and the Hollywood Peace Council. In April of 1940, 8,000 people at a rally, including Erskine Caldwell, who wrote Tobacco Road, Lillian Hellman, Langston Hughes, and Dashiell Hammett, gave a standing ovation to Dalton Trumbo for saying Hitler was crushing capitalism. Five of the future Hollywood 10, Lawson, Bessie, Ornitz, Maltz, and Cole, sent greetings to Hitler from the convention. Dalton Trumbo called Hitler the true savior of the Jewish people. England was being bombed during this time. Paris had fallen. Poland was occupied by both Hitler and Stalin. Jews were barred in Germany from jobs including public office, civil service, journalism, radio, farming, teaching, theater, and film. When France fell, the Hollywood League for Democratic Action sent a telegram of congratulations to Adolf Hitler. And it gets better. Now I want you to keep in mind, what do all leftists do when they hear there's a demonstration of 6 to 10 people who are pro-Hitler? Hundreds of them show out. They yell and scream, they throw rocks and bricks, sometimes they loot and destroy property nearby. It cannot be tolerated. If you are pro-Hitler, it cannot be tolerated for you to even be allowed to speak, unless you're a communist. The 4th Annual Congress of Writers in 1941 opened with a public rally against the United States going to war against Germany. Dashiell Hammett said, going to war with Germany would destroy all that was good and true and honest about Adolf Hitler. He's the guy they're making the Hollywood movie about. I found a copy of the script online for this new multi-million dollar movie coming out. Guess what? They don't mention the Hitler-Stalin pact years. Very clever, you guys, but it's not going to work much longer. John Lawson said writers and artists recognize this war as a brutal, tragic, and corrupt scramble for world markets that has nothing to do with liberating anything. Richard Wright, author of Native Son, stated that the universal demand for peace is the secret weapon of the masses of the common people, which Churchill and Roosevelt fear more than Hitler. We have all heard Chuck say, why were unions picked on for investigation and hearings? Well, he wrongly accuses McCarthy for that because McCarthy wasn't in Washington at that time. But what were those hearings about? The communist-run CIO Machinist Union was on strike at the North American Aviation Company in Los Angeles. The Hollywood 10 all signed a petition in support of the strike, which had as its only goal stopping the FDR war machine. 2 weeks later, the same writers would condemn the strike because Hitler had invaded Poland. Hammett ordered the machinists to end their strike immediately and to support the war to, quote, save Stalin, unquote. The workers were blocked from voting on this and were ordered by the communist-run union to get back to making the machinery of war. Martin Dees, the QAC chair, would later ask United Auto Workers president Inzer about his first meeting on the strike, who was there. He said that there were five heads of the Communist Party USA, and there were five heads of the German-American Bund at the meeting to organize the strike.
Wait, I thought you said it was
the FDR.
You said it was the machinist
you
union,
wait till
not the auto workers, so get your story straight here. Which was it?
He was the head of the UAW, but he was at the meeting called for to organize the strike.
Of the machinists.
One of the pro-Nazis there, Hans Diebel, owned a chain of Aryan bookstores on the West Coast. To prepare workers for the strike, German Bund members and CPUSA members jointly passed out flyers to the machinist union. In May of 1941, HUAC discovered that the Fourth American Writers' Congress was openly pro-Hitler. The German-American Bund actually had a speaker speak at the communist rally. There is a book, The Communist Party, USA versus the CIO, by Mark Campbellman, on the many strikes that happened on the West Coast during the Hitler-Stalin peace pact, all with the same goal, stopping the FDR war machine. John F. Kennedy stated, at the direction of the Communist Party, and for the purpose of carrying out its programs, it betrayed this country. The Communists stuffed boxes for votes, prolonged strikes in the defense industry, long after workers had run out of money and were just tired of the strikes. Did Hollywood influence the political and social climate? That brings me to Poland. The Polish presence in America has never matched its lack of political clout. While the Irish, blacks, and Latinos had to fight for jobs, Poles were never really denied them. Yet the people in Hollywood who were Polish were told to keep quiet about it. Their biographies eliminated all references to them being Polish. Jack and Harry Warner of Warner Brothers were Polish. Samuel Goldwyn was Polish. Louis B. Mayer was Polish. Ernst Lubitsch was Polish. Paul Muni was Polish. Al Jolson was Polish. Yet no one living in those times knew it. Over 1,500 films in the silent era alone were made in praise of Russia. Irish films, over 2,500 films on the subject of Ireland. Not one single film about all the Poles that were here, the Polish people. Only one movie made in Hollywood, The Great Dictator, dared show the oppression of Jews in Germany. That film was the only film Charlie Chaplin ever made that was condemned by the Communist Party USA. 6 million Poles died rising up fighting Hitler. The Communist parties worldwide created the spin that it was a needless slaughter. There was no reason for them to fight back. Yet at the same time, they promoted rebellions that weren't even happening. We now know there was very little resistance in France, Norway. But the real resistance, the real country that rose up against the Nazis, were ridiculed. Those dumb Polish people, why are they trying to fight Hitler? While making films like Casablanca, pretending there's a movement when one actually doesn't exist. John Howard Lawson became the head of Red Hollywood. He and several other Communist Party members started the Screen Actors Guild, Screenwriters Guild. Lawson was in charge and he enforced the party line. His right-hand man was named Otto Katz. He would help set up the phony front groups, like the Hollywood Nazi League. The invasion of the Jewish section of Poland was hailed by the Daily Worker. Even among actors, a pattern emerges. Edward G. Robinson is a loser in the war in the film Destroyer. Paul Heinrich is the Polish failure in Our Time. John Garfield is the Polish failure in Flight School in Air Force. Now let's take a look at the Communist Party oath of that era. What exactly did the Communists say was their goal prior to World War II? I pledge myself to rally the masses to the Soviet Union. I pledge myself to remain at all times vigilant and a firm defender of the Leninist line of the party, the only one that assures the triumph of Soviet power in the United States. How on earth could so many Americans take such a pledge? Now, the views that were around then are still around. Oliver Stone's documentary, I was surprised when I watched it because he said Stalin was the victim. The US and the British were the troublemakers, not Hitler, not Stalin. That's late 30s thinking. I don't even think most communists would agree with that today. I actually believe the Hitler-Stalin peace accords was the beginning of the end of communism. Part of the reason this is left out of history is the Reds' knowledge of what Stalin was really doing. The very idea that Stalin and Hitler were buddies was wiped from the historical record. So who was Stalin? Stalin was neither a victim, nor was he simply a dictator hurting his own people. Stalin was the author of the Cold War. Stalin deliberately sought out a Red Empire. By believing in Russia's victimhood, Churchill and FDR let Stalin and his spies in on almost every level of our government. Before Yalta, Stalin had already set up a pro-Soviet government in Poland, ready to take over. Now, we can't guess the intentions of our leaders. My guess is FDR thought he was fashioning a world where there could be no more war. Churchill didn't trust Stalin as far as he could throw him, and actually urged us to strike Russia with nuclear weapons before the Russians could develop their own. And FDR said, we have no problem with the Russians. Because our nation has not faced this shadow, this evil of Stalin, we still fall for the same crap. When you hear about us working with Iran, reaching out to North Korea, we are being as naive today as we were in the late 1930s when we said, why not let Hitler round up the Jews? It isn't just Hollywood that was a fool for Stalin. By refusing to answer the question, the 10 had effectively stopped the hearings, there would be nothing on the record about how they worked with the German-American Bund. There would be nothing on the record on the strikes that they participated in on the West Coast, the messages that they slipped into movies. There would be nothing. How much nothing? So much that they could look you right in the eye and say the Hollywood 10 were punished because they were premature anti-fascists. That could only be gotten away with if they hid the true history, which they, up until now, have been able to do. Without prolonging... Bogart was baffled. Why didn't they just say, yes, we're communists, so what? That isn't illegal. But that would open the door to explaining their stance on Hitler. Why they thought he was a good socialist. Now, I began my McCarthy study with who gave him the names. And I began this study with why did they choose the defense strategy of not answering the question and ending the hearings on the spot, even taking a year in jail. Because by doing that, they erased the true history of what happened. Now, most Americans have no idea there was a Hitler-Stalin peace pact. They don't know that the communists supported Hitler for 3 years. They don't know any of it. It's all been erased. And they can say Dalton Trumbo was a premature anti-fascist, when in fact, Dalton Trumbo said Adolf Hitler was the savior of the Jews. Do you want to show the film clip of the Hollywood, not the Hollywood 10 that we just watched, but let me see.
Red Communism or the Year in Review, 1947.
You can show both of those. Then we can move on to questions.
Calling the House Un-American Activities Committee to order, Chairman J. Parnell Thomas of New Jersey opens an inquiry into possible communist penetration of the Hollywood film industry. The committee is seeking to determine if Red Party members have reached the screen with subversive propaganda. Mr. Thomas takes an impartial stand in his opening talk.
I want to emphasize at the outset of these hearings that the fact that the Committee on Un-American Activities is investigating alleged communist influence and infiltration in the moving picture industry must not be considered or interpreted as an attack on the industry itself. Nor should our investigation be interpreted as an attack on the majority of persons associated with this great industry. I have every confidence that the vast majority of movie workers are patriotic and loyal Americans.
A long list of prominent motion picture witnesses appear before the committee. Speaking for the films, Eric Johnston, president of the Motion Picture Association, talks frankly concerning the attitude of the producers.
We're accused of having communists and communist sympathizers in our employ. Undoubtedly, there are such persons in Hollywood, as you will find elsewhere in America. But we neither shield nor defend them. We want them exposed. We're not responsible for the political or economic ideas of any individual, but we are responsible for what goes on the screen. We guard that with great care. If communists have attempted to inject their propaganda into the motion picture, they have failed miserably. We will never permit them to succeed.
Thank you. White House, George C. Marshall is sworn in to succeed retiring James F. Burns as Secretary of State. Mr. Marshall is sworn in by Chief Justice Vinson, who is the first to congratulate him. Since there is no Vice President, the new Secretary is next in line to President Truman. The former Chief of Staff and Envoy to China receives good luck wishes from his friend Jimmy Burns and sets out for his new offices in the State Department. Mr. Marshall, who fully realizes the heavy responsibility of directing our complex foreign policies, takes over without committing himself on the future conduct of state affairs. Past performances indicate, however, that the carrying out of our international relationships is in extremely capable hands. For carrier operation, the Navy's new fighter plane packs a high-powered wallop delivered by the most powerful production jet engine in the world. Its wings fold for storage aboard the flat tops, and the jet needs no warm-up, allowing a fast takeoff from the deck to meet surprise attacks. Corky Myers climbs aboard to pilot the Grumman Panther through its first test flight. In action, no catapult is needed to launch her, and a short run of less than 500 feet sees her airborne. Civil war flames in Indochina. Homes are ablaze as French troops clear the outskirts of Hanoi after a siege of weeks by Vietnamese.
There is something on the Hollywood tip coming up, but this thing is too long.
City attack climate.
Which is good. Marshall at the beginning, that is the guy that the CIA gave the fake file to Joe McCarthy. Because when they saw his list, they realized they were real. And the second list, which the American public was never told of Russian spies within the CIA, where all of those people were arrested, McCarthy had gotten from the pond. And the CIA realized he was getting information from a group within CIA, so they dummied up a file on George Marshall, on General Marshall, and gave it to him, accusing him of being a communist. He came forward with that just 2 weeks before the Army hearings, and the CIA smear worked, because Ayn Rand stopped supporting him, William F. Buckley. Conservatives, when they heard him attack Marshall, said, well, this guy's out of his mind, he's just paranoid. They didn't know that the CIA had made a fake file and given it to him to trick him and to shatter his confidence. And that's a fascinating story too. But anyway, most of you will be glad to know that with the exception of my play coming out on Joe McCarthy and me having to go through all this stuff with the press, I'm already working on the other secret history of the United States, which is what it was like in America during segregation. Anyway, thanks for coming.
Okay. Questions?
I have a question.
All right. Okay.
Can I ask the audience? Really, a question to the audience.
He's
anybody
coming.
Here ever heard of the Taft-Hartley law? Raise your hand if you did, please. Okay. So when our speaker comes back, that's what I'd like to.
Okay. All right. Go ahead, Mike. We're going to go into questions now.
Okay.
And I'm going to turn this. All right. Mike, since Brahm's not here, go ahead and raise your hands and go ahead and call on somebody.
Yeah, you said something about so many tons of cereal being sold to either Russia or Germany.
No, they were given.
Given.
To Germany, which there was a boycott that England and the United States had on Germany. but by using Poland, Russia was able to get actually all of the raw materials Germany would then turn into weapons to attack Russia with.
My question is, was it Wheaties or Captain Crunch?
Beats me.
Yeah.
Would you tell me about IBM and Watson, how he gave list of Jews to Nazi Germany living all around Europe? And IBM was highly involved in that. Also, you have the Dulles brothers, who went back to Germany and collected money from Germany because they had investments there. Could you tell me anything about that?
Well, the IBM thing story that I always heard was that they had invented the card file system that the Germans used to keep track of the people in the camps. I never really heard that part before, but what I had heard was that they invented the card system that was used. But I mean, keep in mind that Winston Churchill and FDR both praised Hitler and Mussolini before the war. The thing you have to remember is we were still in the Depression, and the Germans had sort of sidestepped the Depression by dealing in trade. Hitler had learned not to just print money to create economic bubbles. He just skipped over the debt that Germany owed, and he would trade, do like communist deals, you know, I'll trade you this for that. And that's how he was able to get around the debt and build a balloon economy in Germany, which did explode in 1942 before, you know, we were even bombing there. As usually happens with socialist economies, they go down. But I had never heard anything other than that IBM had created the card file.
Edwin Black, and it's a book he's referring to, called IBM and the Holocaust. You'd like it.
How does the
loud, please?
How does the blacklist and the fact that communists were being fired all during that time, and the fact that they were demanding that the Hollywood 10 name names, and that was part of their strategy for what they did. How does that fit in to your scenario?
They didn't really go into the Hollywood 10 because it didn't get that far. They just said, are you a member of the Communist Party? And that was the end of the question. They never got to that.
But you're not answering the question. All during that period, people were being fired and blacklisted. There was a whole thing called Red Channels, and all kinds of people, including labor people who weren't communists, were being fired for being left-wing.
I think that if today you found out that there was people who supported Nazism or fascism, that you would definitely not want them making movies. You would probably be writing letters of protest to the editors. You would probably be joining the people who go to attack these little Nazi cults that have their rallies. I think that once you accept fascism and Hitler, once you have made an alliance like that, there is a price to be paid. And I think it was absolutely correct for people to name names. It was absolutely correct for people to say who was involved in these activities. I have no problem with that whatsoever. And by the way, here's something you don't know. There's still blacklists in Hollywood. If you Google Saturday Night Live blacklist, SNL blacklist, you'll find thousands of articles on the list of names of people who are not allowed to be on Saturday Night Live. Then there are a whole lot of conservatives who work in Hollywood who say they get passed over in work because of their political beliefs. I know people who've worked with Oliver North. He's fired people for saying they back conservatives, Republicans. It's not called the blacklist. It's not being mailed around. But they still, in Hollywood, left and right, have a blacklist.
Was there one single pro-Nazi movie made by these people?
As far as I know, there was no pro-Nazi movie, but the one movie that came out showing how the Nazis were treating the Jews was condemned by the Daily Worker newspaper, which was The Great Dictator by Charlie Chaplin. There was only one film made in Hollywood from the silent era to the sound era that covered that subject matter.
I contend you are conflating two periods in history that are close, but that are different. You have the one during the war, and certainly everybody knows, certainly everybody here knows about the Hitler-Ribbentrop Pact and how hideously embarrassing is only the tip of the iceberg for leftists who, following Stalin's line, be supporting Hitler, and how relieved they were when Hitler actually invaded. That was one thing that happened during the war and then before the war. But then you have these hearings that are happening well after the war. And there, what they're going after is there is this sense that Stalin's operatives have come in and are invading the U.S. government.
Well, that was true, though. The, for example, FDR's scriptwriter was a man named Michael Strait, who was recruited by the Soviet Union in the 1930s at Oxford University. If you go on Facebook and you'll see people will post pro-labor posters on their page with a quote from FDR. Every single one of those was written by Michael Strait, who was a communist. He ends up in the State Department. He turns Raoul Wallenberg into the Soviets for helping to save over 30,000 Jews in Hungary. Raoul Wallenberg is executed in 1947 by the Russians.
Can you give me a cite for that? Because as far as I've ever seen, nobody knows who turned
it. All you have to do, actually, the State Department admitted it, and you can find it on, you can Google Raoul Wallenberg the Pond, and also Raoul Wallenberg on Wikipedia has it, but there's hundreds of articles on it now. Now, here's the thing. Yes, I think the people that supported Hitler before World War II were definitely troubled and were definitely enemies of this country and had a price to pay for that decision. And they didn't pay it. I don't consider the 1 year they spent in jail to be paying the price. What they did was derail the hearing so it couldn't go any further and go into any of those activities. Now, I will say this. Should the hearings have revolved around whether or not someone was a communist or not? I agree with Ayn Rand. She said, you ask them that question first, but then ask them another question. Why were you at this rally with German-American Bund members? Why did you support the rounding up of Jews in Germany? Don't just stop there. And protocol or whatever it was, they would stop as soon as the communists refused to answer the question, and that would be it. They should have gone on to the other question. Why did you support Hitler? And, you know, they didn't. But I think the hearings were in order. No one who was investigated at any time was denied legal access. Lawyers was arrested and charged with anything, was sent to prison at the end of the hearings for their communist affiliation. It was all legal, unlike the Russian purge trials, which involved torture and people being forced to say things that weren't true. But I think Dalton Trumbo was a hero for standing up and saying that what we did was wrong.
Are you open to comments now?
James, did you get those?
There'll be a comments period. There'll be a rebuttal period.
Somebody back here has a question.
There'll be questions and then there'll be
come
comments.
Come on, you don't want to do it, I'll do it.
What's that?
Let's moderate this.
Go ahead and moderate. I'm trying to
film. Yeah, we're going to moderate this.
Have any insight into
come on. One of the things in Poland that happened in the 1920s, of course, was they had open pogroms against Jews. The Catholic Church would whip people into a frenzy about this stuff. You know, because, let's face it, it's the only religion that's ever been accused of killing a god. There's no religion on earth that people have said, you killed Zeus, you killed Hercules. Christianity, up until Vatican II in the early 1960s, said that the Jews killed Jesus. Adolf Hitler was a devout Catholic. He has given many speeches where he said he stands for two things, the working class and Catholicism. Now, why would Jews denounce the religion? I've noticed two strains in Judaism, and it isn't the ones you think of. It isn't Zionism versus whatever, which our president stupidly believes now. What I see is there are people who are very traditional in their beliefs, who believe that they have to stand by their religion because even if they denounced it, guys like Hitler would still kill them. Okay? But there's another strain of Judaism which says, I don't think Moses existed. I don't think there was any lost tribe in the desert. Secular. That, unfortunately, the secular, the so-called progressives of the 1920s and 30s were also believers in eugenics, who believed in you could weed out the bad genetic people from the good genetic people. Everything from Planned Parenthood on were based on theories which Hitler would then take and use as justification for mass murder.
We'll go with Sid and then...
Go ahead, Sid.
Oh, I don't have a question.
Oh, all right, young lady.
I thought we're doing discussion now.
Well, wait a minute. He didn't.
There's been so much said that is so.
Wait a minute. He didn't give you the explanation. The format is we have a presentation. I don't know why. Don't do this on the cheap, okay?
I know.
Come on, Tim.
Okay.
We have a format at the college. I'm beginning in, and we have a presentation followed by question and answer period, and we try to port everyone one or two questions. The next part is followed by everyone has at least about 5 minutes to come to the podium and state their views and opinions. And that's the third part of the program. And then the speaker has one last shot at the end. So let's proceed. Maybe we can keep the answers a little bit shorter so we get a few more
questions.
Well, I have one. Simply because I have opinions of world leaders, of which there's about 190 in the world, and I have opinions of ethnic groups. I suppose you think I should be thrown out of the librarian's profession and precluded from being having a job as a librarian because I have opinions, or even if I'm instructed by someone to have these opinions, I should be punished by being unemployed? I don't perceive why.
Let me ask you a question. When you hear about a college professor who says the Holocaust did not happen, what is your first reaction?
There's academic freedom. But as a person, should I be fired or precluded from being a librarian because somebody decided I have inappropriate views, if it's world leaders, which your presentation was, or my opinions about an ethnic minority? Don't match someone's criteria. Should I be precluded from my profession that I spent years becoming? Getting credentials.
I think just for that, no.
Well, isn't that what happened to these guys?
No.
Our last follow-up question.
I would say doing the strikes on the West Coast.
They had nothing to do with the strikes.
Not the librarians, but the Hollywood 10, supporting those strikes, speaking at the rallies, working in a coalition of different unions, all to have
a union
nothing to do with the workers' conditions
and were solely to help Stalin, that would be cause to fire.
All these guys spoke at union strike rallies.
And by the way, there's two things I want to point out. One of them kind of based on what Chuck is saying. At the end of World War II, the communists found themselves in a rough position at places like Marshall Fields downtown and other places around the country. The communists had said no strikes during the war. We were put aside all labor relations to back the war. Guess who didn't follow that? A group called the Socialist Workers' Party. The socialists had started going into the Shoemakers Union, which was communist, had started going into all these unions, and were taking them over because the workers were going, you mean we can still strike for a higher wage? Now, when the war was over, the Daily Worker printed a series of very fascinating editorials urging their members to contact the Senate and the Congress to hold hearings on which socialists had been active organizing workers during the war when FDR and the communists said there should be no strikes. The socialists were the ones that called for the hearings on the communists. So let's not forget that. That's kind of important. Of course, our government could not differentiate between socialists and communists, so they went after all of them. But keep in mind, we also had the Venona files had already been broken, so we already knew the extent of the infiltration. So Michael Strait writes speeches for FDR, becomes the head of the state, one of the heads of the State Department. Then he becomes the head of the National Endowment of the Arts,
Charlie,
where he
gives
huge amounts of money to beat people doing anti-McCarthy programs. For example, the documentary film Point of Order, you'll find his name on it. And then he becomes the editor of The Nation magazine, which prints that Joe McCarthy was a liar, that he changed the number, that he was a drunk. Every single lie about Joe McCarthy can be found from Michael Strait, the man who was the communist spy who wrote FDR speeches. And that you can find on the internet.
All right.
All right, you got a gentleman here.
You can find the protocols of elders of Zion on the internet.
Isn't it also true that all 10 of them participated in making movies that were anti-fascist?
Yes, they did during the war.
Not before the war?
Mission to Moscow was the pro-Stalin purge was basically anti-fascist ran, but had scenes that in it.
Well, you showed a clip from, Battle for the North Atlantic or whatever it was? That was all about taking military aid to the Soviet Union so that they could fight fascism, right?
Yeah, the aid that they had given to the Germans. Yeah, well, before the war, the Russians flooded Germany with raw materials and food and broke the boycott. And so then Stalin was able, and then they also gave Stalin Messerschmitts, which he was able to use to fly over Russia and drop bombs. So the Russians got a payback for that. And also, keep in mind the reason that Stalin didn't clear out Stalingrad, that he let all those people stay there and would not move them out, knowing the battle that was coming, was that Stalin was willing to go to a level that Churchill and FDR weren't. We already had an idea of when we would stop fighting. When the death level had reached a certain point where we would try to make a deal. We had that. The U.S. and Churchill had a point where that would be it. Stalin had no point.
The Hollywood 10.
Everyone could die in Stalin.
The Germans invaded Russia.
Correct.
When do you just...
make a deal.
No. I said FDR and Churchill had a limit of death. Why do you leave women and children in a town that is about to be engulfed in war for over a year?
Like London?
So the guy invents,
like
you
London,
get him out.
Paris.
All right, who's next? All right, Ernie.
Yeah. Don't you think now Hitler and Stalin had a deal there for a while leading up to the war, which Hitler eventually broke? Don't you think that Hitler had it in the back of his mind from the beginning that he was going to break the deal and they weren't really so buddy-buddy?
Well, actually, it's interesting, but Trotsky and the socialists in their newspapers, which I find fascinating because I found a treasure trove of them. And I found them around the time of Joe McCarthy, and I found them during this period as well, and in the late 30s. So I've been reading through all these socialist newspapers. 2 years before Trotsky died, he said Hitler and Stalin would unite, and that they would start working together. And the socialists also said that the Communist Party USA was nothing more than a spy ring for Stalin, and eventually that was going to come out. They were saying this stuff. Now, I did send out an email to a lot of you guys where I said, does anyone know where the break happened where socialists, Trotskyites, went from the Communist Party is nothing but a spy ring, Hitler and Stalin are going to unite, to where they are now, which is they sound like the whole left on communism. They go, oh, well, those people were unjustly fired. They hadn't done anything wrong. But they were telling the truth in the 30s, late 40s, early 50s. I still haven't been able to find the point where the Socialist Workers' Party goes, well, you know what? The communists were right. Joe McCarthy was wrong. So we're going to back the communists. I don't know when that happened. I'm trying to find that out. It definitely happened. But when you look through the 30s, the 40s, and the 50s, their writings are really fascinating because they predict the Hitler-Stalin alliance. They predict it falling apart. They predict the Communist Party USA is going to become a spy ring along with all the other groups run by the Comintern in Russia. You know, Studs Terkel said to me something that was very fascinating because I asked him directly, what do you think about Russia? And he said, I hate it with all my heart. He said, we had an American labor movement. We had the industrial workers. We had the 8-hour workday. We were concerned with race and more in the unions, in the working class. And all of a sudden, one day, they came to the meeting and they said, our goal is to protect Stalin and Russia. And what happened to the American labor movement? What happened to the American worker?
But you didn't answer my question, which was, don't you think Hitler had in mind to begin with?
I don't know.
He was going to break the deal.
I don't know.
And if why did the deal break?
Okay, Gene?
Andy. It's hard to tell intentions.
Oh, all right, next.
Your speech seemed to be...
Louder, Gene.
Louder.
Pick up.
Pick up.
Your speech, you saying that Satan individual was praising Hitler, praising Stalin, etc., and so forth. And for those actions, they were confronted. Now, me, I'm familiar with history. And we can start from people like Diderot, Jacques Rousseau, Voltaire. The government's biggest threat came from the people that lived in their country. They wasn't running people out of town, putting them in jail, hanging them on the cross when they was talking about somebody else. When they started to point out kings and queens, presidents and heads of state, and what they were doing, those were the people that had to run for their lives. If you ask somebody, say, well, what about a philosopher? What they got in common? And they would go and they'd pick up a big book, try to figure out. I'll tell what they had in common. They all what? Got run out of town.
What's the question, Gene?
What's the question?
That was it.
It's not a question.
It's not a question.
All right, Andy, you got a question?
Yeah, I have a question. Can you tell us, with all the good information you've given us tonight, what can we do? What bearing does this have on solving today's problems and moving forward, addressing global warming, climate change, you know, the melting ice caps, the political destruction of our own government by corporate criminals? How does the history that you've given us help us to deal with problems currently today?
I would say that the left since the 1930s has placed intentions over results over and over and over again. The best intentions, okay, over results that actually work. Right now, our foreign policy, I would call complete anarchy. I cannot believe people criticize me for being a libertarian and tell me I'm an anarchist. I want to keep the military. I want to keep intel. But they're making deals with North Korea. They're making deals with Iran and breaking our alliances with Israel. This is happening from the same weakness that we had in the 30s when we heard the stories of what a great guy Stalin was and we believed it and followed it and made his cause our cause instead of our own conditions being the cause. And I think, I sent a protest letter to the White House on the decision to trust Iran over Israel, which, by the way, since we've done that, we've threatened Iran twice when they moved ships to Yemen and stuff. So I don't know what a great alliance that's going to be, but I think the mistake that Obama made, that he believed that Israel was a colonizer, where what other countries are they colonizing, that he believed that the Palestinians were living as slaves, not true. But he fell for that old 1970s rhetoric, and that rhetoric is the danger. And it was the weakness when we looked at Stalin, and it's the weakness when we look at the leaders of Iran and North Korea and think we can deal with them. We can't. They're nuts.
It's cycling down.
We
ready to go?
Yeah, anyway, I'm set.
Time for comments?
No, I have one question, last question myself. You said, why didn't they just tell the UAC committee that they were communists?
Yeah.
But Congress passed the Internal Security Act in 1950, which was considered even stronger than the Alien and Sedition Act. You get subpoenaed, you go from L.A. to Washington, there's lawyers there, and you say, wait, what is this? They just had an interest in whether or not some people were commies or not? There was no consequences of your testimony?
These hearings
had an interest in knowing who was commies or not.
These hearings were in 47, and in 1947. Why is this cutting on and off?
Because it's a defective mic. You got to speak in front of it. In front of it.
I can't wait to hear the good side of Stalin from this lady. I want to hear this.
You said they were called before the meeting. Why didn't they just admit that?
In 1947, there were none of those loyalty oaths and stuff. You know, I had always heard that Truman was a strong fighter against communism. And then I read what he did. And basically what he did was he put in loyalty oaths. Now, any liberal, any progressive is going to have trouble with the loyalty oath. I'm a civil libertarian. I have a trouble with the loyalty oath. But anyone who actually believes that a communist spy, when asked, are you a communist spy, is going to say, damn it, you got me, man. You got me. Dead to rights. You got it. You won. is crazy.
But he will sign a loyalty oath?
All right.
Yes. All right. Let's thank Mr. Flores.
Yeah. All right.
Your rebuttals.
That's you, Dean. All right. This is our rebuttal period. You get 5 minutes to no personal attacks. And are you keeping time?
I'll keep time. I'm going to allot it for 5 minutes. I'll have a thing. I'm going to go first. I'm going to be very brief.
And he'll give you a little signal when you go on. But anyway, let's thank our speaker again. And again, thank Tim for helping out with the video. All right, let's go to it.
As much as I would like to thank Mike
up here
for this communist and all this stuff that went on in the past, I will say one thing. Let us remember 1989, particularly November, when the windows went up and the walls came tumbling down. The release of Windows 3.1, and of course, the fall of the Berlin Wall, and those ever immortal words from Ronald Reagan.
All right.
Mr. Gorbachev, tear down this wall. And guess what? The benefits of globalization are now spreading wide, and we may see a good century of peace. Capitalism's been delivering the goods for well over 300 years, and I can prove it with a track record. So to all you socialists out there, sorry, you lost.
My question to Flores was simple. All I was asking the question, but anyway, I went off on left, and of course it didn't come out right, or whatever it is. But he mentioned several times about certain individuals, a group of individuals, that seem to be praising somebody here, somebody there, over there, and so forth and so on. Now, and he was saying that for a certain amount of emphasis. Now, what about the reality that I was trying to bring forth here? He and everybody around of a certain age that read two books know historically that when you talk about the 1%, when you talk about the people in charge, and what you said is real and true and factual, your ass might be grass. You're going to have to run this way or that way. They're going to find something else. They're going to get rid of your job, so forth and so on. I mean, this ain't something that made up. This is something that is historical. It's all in the books and so forth and so on. Probably if you're certain age like I am, you done seen all of this stuff. Your biggest threat is your government.
Friends, I came here under an illusion that my husband and I were going to see film reviews. So what a shock. I don't want to do personal attacks, but I hear my father's voice in my head. My father, may rest in peace, would be 98 years old today. And I see the most bizarre rewriting of history and the role of communists in World War II. Some facts that aren't facts, like quoting Donald Stewart as one of the Hollywood Ten. Donald Stewart was not one of the Hollywood Ten. Or, you know, that secular Jews support eugenics and other things that I didn't have time to Google while we were talking, but I'm sure are wrong. But I don't want to talk about bad history. I want to talk about the history I lived in my life. And I want to talk about the role of McCarthyism and how it's affected our country. That's what should be of concern to us. And what role it played in weakening American democracy and the living standards and life of the American people. So why didn't people testify? I'll talk about my father, a World War II veteran, awarded a Silver Star, a Bronze Star, a Purple Heart, fought in World War II, the volunteer to fight Nazism, a communist, came back home, worked in a steel mill, and was called before HUAC and asked, was he a communist? My father was very proud to be a communist, but my father would not testify that he was a communist, because the next question was, who are the other communists?
name names.
Yeah.
And he was proud off the witness stand to say everything he thought, and he was frustrated not to be able to, but he didn't want to put his co-workers and colleagues in the position. When he was fired the next day, along with 13 other workers from the Bethlehem Steel plant in Baltimore, Maryland, that plant had the strongest incentive system of wages in the blast furnace in the country. Why? Because the communists were strong rank and file leaders who united black and white workers, who fought for the workers' rights, and the company was so thrilled to have the excuse to fire them. There might have been 10 people from Hollywood. There were hundreds of thousands of workers across our country who were in unions, who were leaders, in little, not famous or important people, people like my dad, who fought every day for black and white unity, for the rights of the workers, for higher pay, and those kind of things. The result of the, and in 1947, that's when the Taft-Hartley Act was passed. That gave the bosses the ability to just drive out all of the rank and file leaders of the labor movement. We had decades of a labor movement that wouldn't stand up and fight for the workers, that didn't fight for black and white unity, for women's rights, because all of the progressives, not just communists, but other progressives were pushed out under the what was the question they asked my father at the HUAC hearings? This was the threat. If there was a war between the United States and Russia, you might organize the workers to go on strike against Russia, against the war effort, and that would undermine the United States. That was the excuse given to push these people who were mostly interested in fighting for the rights of the workers out of the labor movement. That's the result. That's the impact on our standards of living now. So I think this whole presentation about the communists are unpatriotic and we're fighting for a foreign force, that has nothing to do with the history of the United States and the role, not just of communists, but progressive, of the left wing, of the labor movement in fighting for better standards. We should reject this now. I'm just shocked that anybody would, honestly, no offense, but invite people to come up and tell the same kind of big lies, you know, that brought such devastation on our people.
Next. Okay, Sid. All right.
I don't know. I thought that Goebbels was dead. But I just heard him again. He sounded just like Goebbels. Same thing. As far as Stalin and Hitler pact, what that was about was the fact that Germany was conquering different parts of Europe, like Czechoslovakia, Dayton, and different parts of Europe. And Stalin knew eventually that they were going to invade the Soviet Union. And that's why the Stalin-Hitler pact came about. What he wanted was to have time to develop the 5-year plans so he could fight back. And he moved a lot of this industry that he had in back of the Urals so he could develop its industry so eventually he could fight back. And the other parts of that, everything he said was just propaganda. You could read any right-wing paper at that time and hear the same exact thing that he was talking about. It had nothing to do with reality. It's just distortions in order to make people believe that Russia was no good and it was an aggressor, it was an imperialist country. But if you look at today what's happening, we can see all around the world, the United States has bases in about 108 countries. And it has 41% of the armaments that is constructed today is built by the United States. The United States is nothing but an imperialist power, and it was under that period at the same time. What they wanted was Russia and Germany to fight each other to death And then the United States and Britain would come in and take over the spoils. That's what they actually wanted at that particular time. And things haven't really changed. The United States is still an imperialist power, but it's the number one imperialist power. And it uses any excuse it can. At that time, it used anti-communism. Now it uses anti-terrorism. It's the same thing as before, and it's all you get if you read the newspaper, is distortions of one form or another, anti-Arab sentiment and something like that. All the Arabs are terrorists and all kinds of distortions. The same distortions that he talked about at that time, that they were pushing and peddling. He's nothing but a spokesperson for the reactionary part of the United States. That's all he is.
Next.
I want my check.
Next.
You'll have to ask the Central Committee.
Yeah.
Good evening. Before Lenin ever came to power, he used propaganda. He used persuasion. And he got others to do that as well. And eventually it worked. Martin Luther King said, a revolution must begin in the mind of a man. So I couldn't just hand all of you people machine guns and say, come on, let's overthrow the government right now. Let's go.
Yeah.
You couldn't. You couldn't do that because you're not persuaded. And it may take years, decades, centuries to do that. But the fact is, in Russia, it started about a century or so before the actual revolution in persuading people that we needed to have this new order called communism and that it would mean the brotherhood of all men, only workers in a workers' state where everyone would have plenty, where you would put in everything you produced over and above what you needed and take out whatever you needed. And to a lot of people, that sounded very good. By the way, there was a man named Will Geer, who was openly a communist, and he was blacklisted in Hollywood. He's the guy, in case you don't know, who played Grandpa on The Waltons. And I myself heard him say things that were pro-communist a number of times on that series. So the fact is that the people are fed this kind of corn. The people are fed this kind of corn long enough, they begin to believe it and then to act on it. After all, the sons of these people back in at the time of the Hollywood 10 and so forth, their kids, like people like Abby Hoffman and Jerry Rubin, by the time we got to the 60s, the kids were raising up and acting on all this propaganda that was handed to their generations on and on and on. And so that they were actually going out and making riots in the streets and doing all of that. So the problem with having communists in Hollywood who are making our movies and writing our books and so forth, they are subliminally persuading the people to adopt communist policies. And it has worked very good. If you look around today, this country is more communist than it has ever been before. And we always keep having more and more communist and socialist policies brought into the country to the detriment of capitalism. And that's all I have to say, except for one thing. Somebody mentioned the Comintern. We have a lot of Comintern's here in America. Isn't that that thing that you have on the elevated, you put your money in and you go around it? Thank you.
I got a clock, yes.
Can you turn it around so I can see it?
Yeah, I'm sorry. Okay, yeah.
Hello. I'm Andy Anderson. For those of you that may not know me, I've been giving speeches here a couple times a year for the last 8 years or so, since 2007. And I have a particular hobby, that is, I translate databases. I take 15, 20 books on a subject and translate that wheelbarrow mass of paper into one-page cliff notes that somebody can read in 5 minutes. Because there's no time to read a lot of books. The average person doesn't have time to read 10 or 15 books a week on a variety of subjects that are blacked out by the mainstream media. And as usual, in the past, when I've asked our speaker the question, he's done a brilliant job giving a speech, but when I ask the question, I get a different answer. It's not to my question. I'd like to make a few observations. When you get outside the United States, studies show that the other 95% of the world's people living around the world generically recognize and are fully aware that the United States itself is the greatest source of terrorism on the planet. The amount of terrorism produced by ISIS or Al-Qaeda is minuscule compared to the death toll done by the U.S. military, our $1 trillion budget, and 800 bases all over the world. That's one of the major myths. Americans live in a bubble of mythology. Americans believe that our sons and daughters, granddaughters, grandsons, are fighting for freedom, justice, and foreign lands. That is 180% out of touch, out of phase from the reality on the ground. You want to know what's happening all over the world with the U.S. military, you don't have time to read the last 100 excellent books. Just check out the movie Avatar, a 2.5-hour movie that a week after Avatar came out 4 years ago, one of the articles on the internet said, did you know that the Avatar, those blue alien people on another planet fighting the military, those people actually represent the people in Afghanistan and Iraq. That's what's happening on the ground over there. There is no war in Iraq. There's a controlled slaughter. When you kill 1,000 people for each one of your soldiers that's killed, that's not a war. That's a genocide.
Yeah.
I don't know how many people have famous quotes. It's one of those generic things that goes way back to Confucius' time. Those who do not learn from history are doomed to repeat it. And that's why I ask our speaker tonight, with the knowledge from what we're learning about World War II, does that do us today, applying to problems of today? Albert Einstein had a famous quote. He said, we're in a race. The human race is in a race between education and extinction, and I'm not sure who's winning. That was Albert, and he had a pretty good handle on the atomic weapons program and a bunch of other stuff, and the rate of change that the human race was undergoing. Tim, we have 5 minutes before.
Five.
There are numerous studies, if you do Google searches for immunity to facts, you'll see that studies show that people living in America, our 5% of the world's people, living in the bubble generated by our media, the people in America, a segment of the public, is much more immune to facts than people in other countries. You can give people overwhelming facts and evidence on something and say, well, that can't be true, because if it's not in the news, I won't believe it. In the last week, I had a fellow present to me an idea that how we could save money in this country on law enforcement. He said, we can save a lot of money on law enforcement. For example, if a woman comes into a police station and her clothes are all ripped and she says, I've been raped, I was attacked in the park by a guy wearing a hood, a gentleman told me, he said, well, the police, the proper perspective would be to tell, what's the name of the guy that raped you? Well, I don't know, he had a hood on. Well, and until he steps forward and comes in here and says, I did it, we're not going to investigate. Now, if our police had that attitude, what would we say to them? Well, that's the attitude of some people that are looking at ignoring, they're standing in a blizzard and they can't see a single snowflake on the overwhelming evidence that 7 buildings in New York were blown to dust by a demolition company on 9/11. There's overwhelming evidence that our military is running a devastation program of environmental destruction on a massive scale all over the world. But people just deny it. They say, well, that can't be true, or that'll be on the news. I make one last comment. On July 25th, there's a talk on here called, Facts. We're going to give away documented facts, documented reality. We will give a fact sheet out, what I call a food fight fact sheet. Has anybody here seen the movie with John Belushi called Animal House?
Yes.
Where it goes up for grabs?
Yeah, best movie ever.
Well, we're going to give out a fact sheet that night with 15 facts on it, and at least one of those will be good for an instant food fight. In any conversation you get into, people are going to say, there's no way that can be true. You just fold up that one piece, right, carry it around your pocket or purse, and it'll be good for an instant food fight. Okay. Come July 25th. Thanks.
All right. Next.
My name is Scott Marshall. When our speaker started out, he said, why didn't they just say they were communists? And so I'll just say, I'm a communist. So people are clear. And a proud member of the Communist Party.
Yeah, who with? With who?
What do you mean with who?
That's the next question. Name names.
Oh, yeah, right, of course. Well, nowadays we don't worry about that. Because there's... But I want to say that the context of the remarks are really kind of remarkable for being in outer space. First of all, according to the rules of that testimony, as soon as they answered a question, yes, I'm a member of the Communist Party, then if they refused to say who of their friends were members of the Communist Party, they would be found in contempt of Congress. So it wasn't just, just go out there and say whatever you want to say. People were being thrown in jail for those kinds of things. It's ironic to me that in the clips that we saw about the Hollywood 10, and I can't remember the name of which guy it was, that he fought in Spain against fascism. He went to Spain with the International Brigades. The International Brigades were backed by the Soviet Union. They were backed by communists all over the world. Our party in the United States recruited dozens and dozens of people to go to Spain to fight against fascism in Spain. Anyway, just an interesting tidbit. I think the most important thing about the McCarthy period had nothing to do with the Hollywood 10 or any of the cultural stuff. That was all, that was bad for people, there's no doubt about it. But the real context of that was stopping the labor movement. The attack, McCarthyism was all about getting rid of the CIO. It was all about moving leaders and not necessarily communists. A lot of the people that were thrown out of their unions, a lot of people Joe McCarthy went after were never communists.
Thank you, Gene.
But they were people who fought for the union. And that's why they were getting, and McCarthy used the red thing as a shield to go after everybody in the labor movement that's fighting back. So what does that have to do with today? I'm pretty sure everybody in here knows, whether they want to admit it or not, that there is a huge attack on the labor movement in this country today. I'm with the Steelworkers Union. I work with the retirees of the Steelworkers Union. Look at the laws that are being passed. Right to work laws. Look at Rauner. Look what Rauner's trying to do with this right now. You know there's national right to work legislation in Congress?
Yeah.
And they're going after every single union. Why? Gee, I wonder why. But let's take a look at another side of this question, and that is, look at what's beginning to happen in the labor movement in this country today. It's just like the 30s in many, many ways. You see the rise of young workers in the retail trade. You see the fast food, the fight for 15, the Walmart workers. All of this is reminiscent of how the unions got started. I talk to my retirees and I say, when we used to go to work, when our great-grandfathers and grandmothers and grandfathers and grandmothers went to work in those mills, those weren't good jobs. Nobody went there because, hey, I want to have a career in steel. People got killed on the job all the time. You got terrible diseases and all kinds of stuff. It took the union to turn those into decent jobs, not the benign whatever of U.S. Steel and Republic Steel, which, by the way, right here in Chicago, murdered 10 people because they wanted to form a union. Well, that's the kind of attack that's coming down on the labor movement today, and people are fighting back, and they are going to come at us with the same kind of stuff, the same kind of crap, and they already are. They already are. What? Listen to Rauner. He sounds like Joe McCarthy in many, many ways. Anyway, I just want to say one other thing. Salt of the Earth was also mentioned or shown on the thing. Salt of the Earth is such a beautiful movie, if you hadn't seen it. And it was made by blacklisted communists who were no longer able to work in the industry. And that movie champions not only working class unity between black and between white and Latinos, but it champions the right of people to have unions and to fight for a better way of life. And I think that's one of the most beautiful movies ever made, and it was made by communists, including Will Gear. I'm sorry.
No problem. Yeah, thanks. Thanks.
All right, let's thank our speaker again. You're entirely correct, sir. The woman who stars in that movie was blacklisted. I don't know if before or for being in that movie. I guess that's appropriate. Who knows? But she probably had very bad views. And she deserved not to be in regular mainstream Hollywood, I guess. All right, let's see. I'll be eclectic here as usual. Got a lot to go over here. Regarding Bogart, I don't follow stars, but I do know he was the most outspoken opponent of this investigation. And then he flew to Washington, and then he got very quiet and didn't say anything after that, except for the fact that, well, maybe I was outspoken, but that was maybe not well thought out. Or the best, maybe not appropriate. That's all they can say on it. I don't know what they did, what they told this guy. But then again, Mike gets up here and says, well, you could just tell them you're a communist, and they're going to tell you, well, that's okay. We just want to know, because we were curious. And we want to know if any commies were around. We're not going to do anything about it, so thank you. No, that's just not the way it works. This is right-wing totalitarianism in action. You're entirely correct, young lady, regarding the union officials getting thrown out. They went after union officials. Okay, we pay attention to the Big Ten here. But they really purged the unions. They're the really good union officials. I've known some of these guys. And they were thrown out. And Walter Reuther of the auto workers, from what I understand, was the only one who kind of stood up for his men. And they were coming after his stewards and union officials. And they said, you got commies in your union all over the place. And he told them, from what I understand, he told them to get lost. Because he said, I'll make arrows
out of any kind of wood, and it's none of your concern. I read a lot of labor history and lecture on it, but I often wonder how many names are left out of those books of people that stood up. Every union organizer faces a blacklist today, tomorrow, in the past. It's a thing, you pay for saying the emperor has no clothes, for standing up and saying, no, you're not going to do this to us anymore. Now, I don't really know what all this stuff about foreign affairs or opinions of views or ethnic groups has to do with anything. These guys were targeting people for their views and their opinions and their affiliations. It's none of your goddamn business what, because I have views or opinions. Look, do you know how many views and opinions I've listened to in 25 years? I've never once felt the need to punish somebody. What groups do you belong to? I belong to so many groups, I have no idea. I don't even know when they'd come to or not. If they look kind of cool to me, I learned that. Give them a few bucks, join them. I'm on paper, some of them are active. Who knows? I'm going to get retribution for having been affiliation with some organization. That's an absurdity. Now, the only thing you can find people guilty of under these laws that they have, Internal Security Act, to me, is an act of espionage. I don't know what that is, but I guess if you give some kind of secrets or stuff to the enemy and give them an advantage if you're at war, but these guys are writing stupid movies and love stories and other things like that. And I don't know what value any of that collectively is for an enemy of the United States. If you took all their scripts and had a pile of them and said, here, let me say, so what? What do I want this stuff for? Now, I'm rather pleased to learn that sappy show, I lived in West Virginia, so I used to watch this. The Waltons has got commie stuff in it. And old Gramps was a commie. I'm going to have to be watching that from now on. That show sounds like it's got some value here. But anyhow, this is a dark episode in the history of our country. Let's learn from it and don't let it happen again. These forces of darkness are out there, and they're willing to put you away. All right, you're another force of darkness here. But anyhow, thanks a lot, Mike. I argue with Mike all the time, and he's got all kinds of hooey about McCarthy, which is entirely incorrect. But anyhow, he gives us some things to talk about here. Really, this is a period that possibly we should not forget about. Never forget about this. What happened? Absolutely never, ever allow this to happen again. Okay, All right.
Next.
All right. Keeping notes.
Okay. All right. You know, I was. All right. I listened to real interesting presentations. A presentation about communist influence in Hollywood. I'd just like to say that I'm very glad to see that Mike Flores opposes Nazism. Okay, I'm always happy to. And I wanted to say that in his favor, and I mean that in all seriousness. That I'm always glad to find another person who, like me, opposes the Nazis. Now, that and I don't believe in. Now, unlike Mike, I don't believe in putting people in prison for holding the wrong political beliefs, or for writing books or making movies that the government doesn't approve of. I'll leave that to the Nazis and the communists to do that. But I don't think that's what the United States of America is all about. I'm still enough of an old-fashioned American to believe in freedom of speech, freedom of the press.
Get his name.
So yeah. Start aiming right. Exactly. This is exactly the sort of thing I'm talking about. So, but I do want to say that I agree with Mike about opposition to Nazism. I think the Nazis were just the absolute worst scumbags in the whole history of the world, and
And I think that those who sympathize with the Nazis, again, I'm not saying that a person who expresses support for Nazism should just be put in prison for that. I'm not, you know, but I, what I am saying is that I think we should, I am saying that I think there should be some kind of consequences for people who do that, and that I think that at the very least we ought to you know, boycott or bring it out into the open when someone does try to support the Nazis. And I'll give you an example of this. I don't know how many of you, I just want to ask everybody here in the audience, how many of you have heard of the Malmedy massacre? Okay, not a person. Okay, one guy. All right, I'll tell you all what it was. It was during World War II. How much time I got left, Tim?
About 3 minutes.
Okay, it was during World War II, and it was U.S. troops in Belgium. This is during the Battle of the Bulge, which was our troops were already in France and Belgium, and then there was a counterattack in December of 44. Let me take this jacket off. There was a counterattack in December of 44. By the Germans, and a group of American troops were captured by a bunch of SS guys, and they were systematically slaughtered. They were taken prisoner, and then, and this is total violation of the Geneva Convention. They were then massacred. They were wiped out. Only a few guys survived by pretending they were dead. Because the Nazis went around through the farm field where they shot these guys, and any guy that showed any signs of life, they would put a bullet in his head. Now, and I talked to one of the survivors at a military convention a few years ago. It was absolutely horrible. I also have read a book on this subject. It's called and I recommend the book to everyone. It's called Fatal Crossroads. But anyway, now, what happened to the Nazis who did this? This is a war crime, so you'd think they'd get tried with war crimes, right? And they were, except that a member of the U.S. Congress intervened and put the war crimes tribunals to a stop in 1947. This man was a freshman senator who had invited himself over on a congressional fact-finding junket to Europe. And he arranged to stop that, and eventually to actually stop the Nuremberg War Crimes Tribunals. They'd already convicted the top Nazis, but they were going after second-tier guys. But this senator managed to stop it. That senator's name was Joseph McCarthy, and he managed to the commandant of the SS troops at Malmedy, the guy responsible for this slaughter of our troops. This guy, his name was Colonel Joachim Piper. So he got off and he went on and lived a quiet life in France until some vigilantes murdered him in the 1970s. That's another story. But in any case, he never got convicted of this atrocity in a court of law. So, all right. So I just wanted to let you know that. So anyway, it was good old Joe McCarthy who helped get this guy off.
Yeah, he liked him.
Who else? Anybody else rebutting? Okay, Mike.
Well, we got a lot of stuff to cover here.
You get the last word, and you got about 15 minutes or so.
The Malmedy massacre. That story's been debunked a long time ago. What actually occurred was, as happened at Dachau, had happened in other places our U.S. troops went into, we began torturing and beating and killing the Nazis as soon as we got our hands on them. And the Pope, because remember, Joe McCarthy was Catholic. He was isolated from the WASPs because you have to go back to an America that believed in segregation, to an FDR that backed lynching, that threw Paul Robeson out of the White House for saying he should back the Republican federal anti-lynching law FDR had him thrown out of the White House. When I said earlier that the era of segregation, next to the Cold War, is the most censored, politicized era you can imagine. I wasn't kidding. So the Pope asked Joe McCarthy to intervene at Malmedy because there were men with broken arms, legs, necks, shoulder bones from the GIs torturing them to get confessions. And then the soldiers who were interviewed about what had happened there, it became less and less clear what was going on.
Thank you.
They decided they would use torture to get the information. The Catholic Church, by the way, thanked Joe McCarthy for intervening when none of the WASP senators would. Now, let's start running through some of this stuff. There's a lot. First off, you want to look up on Google. You want to Google, ma'am?
I forgot her name, ma'am.
You want to Google Margaret Sanger, Ku Klux Klan. You will discover then by going there about the eugenics movement that the progressives believed in. The feminist movement was born in the KKK, and you'll see pictures of Sanger. You can look, you've got the cell phone. You've got the internet right there. There are photos of Sanger speaking at KKK rallies, the founder of Planned Parenthood.
Women had no issues except the KKK.
I thought it was actually, Ku Klux Klan women could get businesses, could get loans from banks without a man's cosign, which other women could not. But if you Google Margaret Sanger, KKK, you'll see her speaking at KKK rallies. Now, I want to point out, too, that not even the communists that spoke to anything I said. We hear about Goebbels, we hear about this and that all through the night. But he didn't say, you know what, Mike? I think the communists were wrong. I think they should not have backed Hitler. I think at least they should not have backed Hitler without speaking to the membership. I think in the 1950s, when the Communist Party told everyone we were now in a fascist state and to go underground, and members showed up at their study group meetings and there was no one there because they had gone underground, may have been a mistake. These may have been errors to transfer from fighting for workers' rights to defending Stalin and the Soviet Union. That's all you have to do to debunk me. Just go, Mike, you know what? You got a point. You're right. We shouldn't have backed Hitler.
Thank you.
That was a mistake. But he can't say that because the party hasn't decided if it was a mistake or not. In fact, it doesn't even discuss it. It says everyone was premature, anti-fascist. That brings us to the international brigades in Spain. That was an interesting concept. There were two movements at that time amongst the communists. One, which came first, was sending thousands of people who supported Stalin's Russia and wanted to help build it. A man by the name of Pete Seeger raised money for that. So did Woody Guthrie. So did Paul Robeson. Thousands of American, European, Latin American people went to Russia to help Stalin. 4 months after they arrived there, Stalin ordered them to be arrested and murdered. All of them. For years to come, everyone from Seeger to Guthrie, all of these guys got letters from relatives. Where are our relatives? We haven't gotten a letter from them. We haven't heard a word of what happened to them. But they can't criticize that because their party has not admitted that has happened to this day. It'd be very easy to pull the rug out from under me. Mike, you know what? we decided that backing Hitler was wrong, and that hiding the fact that we backed it was wrong, and that by telling people we were premature fascists was wrong. It was a lie. It was a lie on the scale of Goebbels. But to do that, you have to follow democratic centralism. You have to have your party admit it was wrong first. And they haven't. So they can come up and they can blast me, but was it really right to back Hitler? Was it really right to not go to the membership and talk to them about this big change happening? They can't say anything. Now, in Spain, the soldiers that went over there, who were not properly trained, in my opinion, were betrayed. They were waiting for airplanes to come bomb, and instead they were told it was time to flee the country. Because Stalin had just made a deal with Hitler. And therefore, he was withdrawing all support of the international brigades in Spain. This is not something I would want to bring up to someone who knows history. Now, was it right for the communists to call for hearings on what the socialists had done in unions during World War II? If you're going to be against blacklists, where exactly were they going with this? The fact was, the socialists in unions, like the RWDSU, had grown in power and influence because they still backed strikes during the war. How do you get them unseated? You have hearings. And with your hearings, you expose the socialists and get them out. I can't help it if their movements ended up getting them thrown out. But they started it. I'm always curious about, I don't know where Chuck is, I guess he's wandered off, but that someday someone's going to have to explain to me how you can go about wanting a violent revolution against the United States government and be against people owning guns. I need to have that explained to me. As for our military, I would just like to say that our military in the United States is the most revolutionary force of any military on earth. And not only that, I believe it is the last thread that we have to our revolutionary times. Let me explain. When Democrats supported lynching and segregation, the military let blacks in. When the blacks left the military, they didn't want to go back to no jobs and being segregated. When we were arguing about whether women could fight or be warriors, it was the military that brought women in. And then, when this country was saying things like being gay is against God, it was the military that changed our whole way of looking at that and brought gays in, changing our culture. And I'll tell you what, if the military ever says it's okay to smoke pot, we're going to see a change nationally as well. But our military is the most revolutionary force in our country today. Let's remember that on Memorial Day. Yes, they have to obey orders. Yes, if the president tells them to move arms from Benghazi to Syria, they will. How did we know they were arming ISIS? But those are things they have to do as the military, or we would have coups like they do in Latin America every few years. The fact that the military in the United States has never had a coup is something we should be proud of, because this side of the world, it happens a lot.
That it?
Now, it wasn't just Joe McCarthy that was smeared. I'm also in touch with Jane Fonda. Jane Fonda, as you know, this will get people mad from the Vietnam era, was shown posing in artillery in North Vietnam, etc. Well, I've been in touch with Jane because in my research through declassified files, I discovered that the group that sent her to exchange POW letters was not only heavily infiltrated by the CIA, but the guy who actually is in the photo off to her right, who has round eyes, is an Asian, and moved her onto the artillery battery to have her sit on it for the photo, is CIA. So whether it's Joe McCarthy or Jane Fonda, if the CIA smears you, you stay smeared. They're really good at smearing people.
Yeah.
Now, by the way, I am a libertarian, but I'm not anti-union. I'm actually pro-union. I do think people should be able to choose whether they join a union or not, but I am not anti-union, and I don't support breaking up unions. I am a little bit concerned that there are so many cities that say, we can't cut 24 intel agencies. We can't cut any government agencies. We can't cut 350,000 government jobs here in the city. We can't cut them. We have to keep them even if we descend to the level of Detroit. That is insane. At some point, we are going to have to make cuts. And we're going to have to admit the game that the Democratic Party plays. They use people like Chuck to go to the front line. And Chuck walks in and says, we're for workers' rights. We're for everybody getting a fair shake. Enough of this. And then the guys he supports come in behind him and say, we're going to close 50 schools so we can build a soccer stadium and a college. High five. How long does this game go on before you say to that guy, no more? At any rate, you will notice that when I asked directly the people from the Communist Party, was it right for the Communists to back Hitler? They left. They didn't deny it, they didn't agree, they just left. If you've ever protested Nazis, skinheads, said it was wrong for them to be teaching at colleges, it's wrong for them to be going out and preaching their stuff in the streets, you have to start including the Communist Party. Thank you.
Mr. Gorbachev, tear down this wall.
Mr. Netanyahu, tear down this wall.